Hello, I'm Congressman Charlie Dent. I'm proud to be the sponsor of the Bipartisan Enemy Expatriation Act, which I introduced in the House this week, along with Representative Jason Altire of Western Pennsylvania. Identical legislation was also introduced in the Senate by Senator Joe Lieberman, Chairman of the Senate Homeland Security and Government Affairs Committee, and Senator Scott Brown of Massachusetts. With the recent death of U.S.-born radical cleric Anwar al-Awlaki, the sanctity of American citizenship and its crucial role in our dialogue regarding national security is now garnering increased and bipartisan attention in both chambers of Congress. I'm hopeful this renewed attention will increase the awareness of and support for the Enemy Expatriation Act. The bipartisan legislation I introduced this week calls for a pragmatic recognition that a person who is purposefully and materially supporting acts of terror against the United States is demonstrating that they have no intent in acting as a U.S. citizen. If they want to engage in hostilities against the American people, then they clearly no longer wish to be a citizen of our great nation. Notably, this legislation would only modify an existing statute or law which has already been found constitutional by the United States Supreme Court. Currently, an individual who engages in hostilities against the United States on behalf of an armed force of a foreign state has committed an expatriating act. Our legislation clarifies that engaging in hostilities by supporting terrorism would also constitute an expatriating act. Decades ago, the greatest threat to our national security was posed by foreign states, including Nazi Germany and Imperial Japan. Today, however, international terrorist networks, like Al-Qaeda, have equaled and in some cases exceeded the threat posed by any foreign state currently hostile to the United States. Simply put, this bill modernizes the process by which the citizenship status of an individual engaged in hostilities against the American people is examined by treating terrorists in the same manner as a U.S. citizen who marched through the Third Reich decades ago. I believe it is time Congress update existing law to reflect the modern threat of global terrorism. Let me be clear. The bill does not modify the prerequisite that a defendant must be found to have voluntarily relinquished his citizenship. I believe being an American citizen is more than a right. It is a responsibility. When individuals such as Anwar al-Awlaki take actions that are proven threats against the United States, they violate that responsibility, and our nation should respond in an appropriate manner.
We're talking about ways to bring an end to this war. And we, as Muslims, we want to bring an end to terrorism more than anybody else. And our position needs to be reiterated and needs to be very clear. The fact that the U.S. has administered the death and homicide of over 1 million civilians in Iraq, the fact that the U.S. is supporting the deaths and killing of thousands of Palestinians does not justify the killing of one U.S. civilian in New York City or Washington, D.C. And the deaths of 6,000 civilians in New York and Washington, D.C. does not justify the death of one civilian in Afghanistan. There is anger and resentment, but not hatred. Hatred seems to be something that comes out of nowhere. There are reasons for this resentment. The U.S. is the only reason for the survival of some governments in the Middle East. Governments who have some of the worst track records of human rights in the world. And these are the allies of the United States in the Middle East. Muslim governments. But they are dictatorships, tyrannical, totalitarian regimes. And if it is not the U.S. who's backing them, they would crumble one after another. The U.S. needs to support freedom and human rights in the Muslim world. Because the people in the Muslim world only saw America as their enemy when they saw America supporting these governments. They had nothing against America. They are concerned with what's going on in their own countries. But because they tried to change the situation in their countries, and they fail because whenever they try to change it, the U.S. comes and helps their so-called allies, that is why they're turning their anger towards the U.S.
While we don't want fear to govern our daily lives, the failed terrorist attack in Times Square in May 2010, along with the attempted attack on Flight 253 on Christmas Day 2009, are grim reminders that we are fighting a war against terrorists aiming to dismantle American ideals and our way of life.
Well, you can certainly sense the anguish with Dr. Nasser al-Awlaki. He wanted to make it clear that his son is not a member of Al-Qaeda. He claims that he does not believe that his son met with Abdul Muttalib, the man accused of trying to blow up that plane on Christmas Day. And further, he says, look, my son is a wanted man. He's cornered. He is not hiding out with Al-Qaeda. But once the missile started in his village, he had no choice, really. He had to seek protection from his own tribe in the mountains here in southern Yemen. I just want to read you some of the quotes that he gave us. He says, I am now afraid of what they will do to my son. He's not Osama bin Laden. They want to make something out of him that he is not. You know, his father saying, look, he has controversial views, but that's not the same as advocating terror and inciting terrorists to commit violent acts. He says he wants to try and convince his son to try and perhaps surrender himself, talk to the Yemeni authorities, talk to the American officials, and he says, I will do my best to convince my son to do this, to come back, but they are not giving me time. They want to kill one of their own citizens. This is a legal issue that needs to be answered. And he's speaking there both about the Yemeni government and the American government. But it was extraordinary to hear this man talk about his son so completely differently than what the media, certainly, and the American official line about him and the Yemeni official line than has been. He says, look, he is a preacher. And in being a preacher, yes, he has had more controversial views over the last few years, but he is definitely not a member of Al-Qaeda. He has been wrongly accused. It's unbelievable. He lived his life in America. He's an all-American boy. My son would love to go back to America. He used to have a good life in America, and now he's hiding in the mountains. He doesn't even have safe water to drink.
It was an astonishing bulletin today. Another public enemy taken out by the United States. The Al-Qaeda leader called the most dangerous man in the world, the American citizen Anwar al-Awlaki, who used his knowledge of U.S. culture and U.S. language to recruit terrorists. So how did they find him? We have full team coverage tonight, and we're going to begin with ABC's Martha Raddatz, who is overseas, has gathered gripping details from her post tonight, the war zone of Afghanistan.
The U.S. had been zeroing in on al-Awlaki's location for months. In their sights, a compound deep in the backcountry of Yemen, where U.S. military and intelligence operatives were certain the American-born terrorist was hiding out. What al-Awlaki could never know was high overhead, American surveillance aircraft and satellites were watching that compound 24 hours a day while armed drones flew nearby. All they needed was al-Awlaki to step out into the daylight. They waited and waited. Until this morning, al-Awlaki, one of the most wanted terrorists in the world, walked out and climbed into a pickup truck. A huge break. As he began to drive, thousands of miles away, likely at CIA headquarters in Langley, Virginia, action. Operators using remote controls raced the drones into position. Within moments, the drones lock in on the vehicle as it sped along a roadway below. A special joint operations plane beaming back real-time tracking, fighter jets in the skies as well. And at 9:55 a.m., the drones fire more than three Hellfire missiles, hitting the vehicle carrying al-Awlaki, which erupts in flames. His was the only vehicle hit. another huge victory in the war on terror.
The death of Awlaki marks another significant milestone in the broader effort to defeat Al-Qaeda.
An effort that required pinpoint accuracy.
Capabilities that they have allow them, for example, to be a mile overhead the target, but, for example, identify a specific car, even down to its license plate.
Also killed in the vehicle, another American citizen, Samir Khan, who edited Awlaki's terror inciting online magazine, Inspire. Awlaki was considered an inspiration for the Fort Hood shooter, the attempted Times Square bomber, and played a major role in the attempted bombing of an American-bound jetliner.
Remember how we had killed Anwar al-Awlaki? He was a person who did propaganda for Al-Qaeda in Yemen, basically. And President Obama's administration claimed that he had moved into an operational role. They did not provide much evidence, or really any evidence of that, because they felt that we're the government, we don't have to provide evidence. He was born in New Mexico, was a United States citizen, and he was killed in a drone strike in Yemen. Now we have done something that is very unfortunate. We have apparently killed his son as well, who had just turned 16 a month ago. Abdul Rahman al-Awlaki and a 17-year-old cousin were attending a barbecue, and you could very fairly say that there was not a pleasant barbecue given who was attending. Our government claims that Ibrahim al-Bana, an Egyptian media chief for al-Qaeda's Yemeni affiliate, was also there. Apparently, from our gathering of the news stories, he was probably the target, although the United States government will not tell us who the actual target was. Apparently, everything is secret. We kill U.S. citizens who are teenagers, and we don't even tell the American people who the intended target was. The number of people killed is actually 9, including the two teenagers, including a United States citizen. So now the Awlaki family, which had remained quiet throughout for understandable reasons, is going public with this. And in fact, there's even a Facebook group supporting Abdul Rahman al-Awlaki, and basically, of course, at this point, criticizing the United States government for, well, I was going to say executing him, but we're not really sure who they were executing because they won't tell us. But he, nonetheless, has been killed. And it leads to a great question. I mean, what can't our government do? And what can they keep secret? Was he the actual target? Can you at least tell us? Is that too much to ask for? And shouldn't we know whether we're executing teenagers on purpose or by accident, let alone U.S. citizen teenagers? You know that initially the United States government said that he was in his 20s and was a militant. When pressed on it, and in fact the Washington Post found his birth certificate, well, there it is. They're like, oops, yeah, I guess he wasn't in his 20s. So that leads to a good question asked by the New Yorker, which is, was our government lying about the fact that he was in his 20s? Or was there evidence on him so thin and they wound up dropping a bomb on his head and killing him anyway?
We cannot and we will not allow them to triumph. I anticipate that the introduction of this bipartisan legislation will urge Congress to move quickly to amend our current law in a manner that reflects the global conflict that we face today.